Welcome, everyone. I'm Gary Jenkins. I'm Dean of the Law School, and it's a real pleasure to welcome everyone to our panel today for Spring Alumni Week. We have a lot of Minnesota Law alumni and students and faculty and staff logged in, and we're really thrilled to present this panel discussion for all of you. While I wish that we could all be together in person, I'm grateful that we can connect today. So before we begin, just a few notes. Today's webinar is being recorded, and the link to the recording will be shared via email following the link. And also, you should know that we have the live audio captioning enabled. So please feel free to click on live transcription. You can either turn that feature on or off, whatever is your preference. It's at the bottom of your Zoom screen, and you can have that set to your likings for our discussion. You all are all truly the foundation of our Minnesota law community, especially during all of the challenges of the past year. So I want to thank you for your engagement, for your continued generous support, for your passion for Minnesota law. It enables us to bring talented students here to ensure that they are taught well and supported by caring staff, and that the community benefits from powerful research and outreach. I'm very grateful for all of you. And the second thing I want to say thanks to for is our terrific advancement team. They've organized the events of the week, and I especially want to thank Alyssa Chafee for organizing tonight's event. Now, before I introduce our speakers for tonight, I want to acknowledge two of our most distinguished alumni who aren't with us tonight. The first is Vice President Walter Mondale, class of 56. His death is a tremendous loss to our community, as well as to the state and the entire country. As a politician and a public servant and a diplomat and a lawyer, he's had the kind of career that we hope all students aspire to. The values of leadership and service that underlie our work were embodied by Walter Mondale. He loved this law school, and we loved him back. I have so many fond memories of him, including the students serenading him in song. To the music of Hamilton, they changed the words to Walter Frederick Mondale instead of Alexander Hamilton, and the song talked about his impact on our country and his impact on them as future leaders, and he loved it. He lit up. He was so kind, so full of wisdom and humility. So if you have not had a chance to look at our memorial article, our virtual tribute book, we're asking alumni and students and faculty together to share memories and thanks for his life. So please take a look at those, both of which were in the email that you should have received from me earlier today. And the second person that I also want to acknowledge is another alumnus who was supposed to be with us this evening. He was supposed to be on this very panel. He actually came up with the idea to do this as part of Spring Alumni Week. When we were sitting together in his office in New York City and came up with this idea. I'm talking about another dear friend, Judge Paul Fineman, class of 85. He was a judge on the New York Court of Appeals. That's, of course, that state's highest court. He recently lost his battle with leukemia and just passed away on March 31st, one week after stepping down from the court because of his health. Judge Feinman was a great friend to this law school, to me personally. Speaking, he was always willing to come and speak to our students, to mentor our students, to hire our students. He was a true Minnesotan at heart, even though he was a judge in New York, and he loved our law school, and we miss him dearly. So with that, I want to get us started. I want to get us started on the substance, and I want to introduce our distinguished panel and our moderator, because we are in tonight for a great discussion. So our first panelist is Justice Barry Anderson. He's a member of the class of 79. He served on the Minnesota Court of Appeals from 1998 until his appointment to the Minnesota Supreme Court in 2004. Prior to serving on the bench, he was a partner at the law firm of Arnold Anderson and Dove. He served the city of Hutchinson as city attorney from 87 to 98. He's a frequent visitor in Mondale Hall, and we appreciate him. Thank you, Justice Anderson, for being here. And our second panelist is also another great friend of the law school, Justice Natalie Hudson, a member of the class of 82. She was appointed to the Minnesota Supreme Court in 2015. Prior to that, she served on the Minnesota Court of Appeals starting in 2002. Her professional experience includes serving as a staff attorney with Smurls, as an associate attorney at Robbins Kaplan, as assistant dean at Hamline Law School, and as St. Paul City Attorney. From 1994 until her appointment on the court, she was with the Minnesota Attorney General Criminal Appellate Division. So welcome, Justice Hudson. And then our third panelist is Justice Janine Kern, a member of the class of 85. She's celebrating her slightly delayed 35th reunion this week. So we congratulate her on that. She was appointed to the Supreme Court of South Dakota in 2014. Prior to serving on the court, she worked in the Attorney General's office from 85 to 96 in the Appellate Division and served as Director of the Litigation Division, among other things. And she was appointed a judge in 1996, served 18 years on the trial bench before becoming a member of the South Dakota Supreme Court. Welcome, Justice. And moderating tonight's discussion is Judge LaJune Lange, class of 78. Judge Lange began her legal career with the Hennepin County Public Defender's Office until she was appointed to the bench. She served as a judge on the Fourth Judicial Court here in Minnesota, handling complex civil and criminal cases until her recent retirement after 21 years on the bench. In her retirement, she is Honorary Counsel of South Africa in Minnesota, President of the International Leadership Institute, and serves as a fellow with the Roy Wilkins Center for Human Relations and Social Justice at the Humphrey School of Public Affairs, and is an adjunct faculty at St. Thomas Law School. Welcome, Judge Lange. So with that, I will just say one last word of detail. We will reserve time at the end to address your questions submitted via the Q&A feature found at the bottom of your Zoom screen. So once again, welcome to all of you. Welcome to our judges, justices, and over to you, Judge Lange.
Thank you so much, Dean Jenkins. It is an honor to be part of this program tonight at the University of Minnesota Law School. While we were sad with the passing of Walter Mondale and Judge Feinman, what stellar careers they had. It's an honor to the law school to have them as alums. And now we are going to proceed. I will ask the first question to Justice Barry Anderson. And the first question is, at what point did you decide that you were interested in becoming a judge? And what about it appealed to you at the time? And if you turn on your microphone, then we'll hear from you.
So thanks so much, Judge Lange, for the question. Dean Jenkins, thanks for that introduction. I'm going to take just two quick little detours. I just want to tell one very quick Walter Mondale story. I did not know former Vice President Mondale well, but I had run into him professionally in a couple of matters. And also I had the privilege of being with him at an appearance that he and former Governor Al Quie were at the Supreme Court Historical Society, Minnesota Supreme Court Historical Society. This is probably 5-6 years ago, something like that, where the two of them talked about their experiences in government and particularly as it intersected with judicial selection. And it was just a fascinating hour and a half to hear these two giants of Minnesota history. One is still with us, one has left us, but what a great privilege to have had them as public servants. The second thing I just want to say is it's always a pleasure to come back to the university. I'd like to be doing this live at the law school. This will suffice. I'm sure it'll be great. I have great memories from my time at the law school. Then there are some other memories I don't recall anymore, and that's probably just fine. So let's talk a little bit about how I managed to wind up as a judge. And I begin with the observation for those law school students who have with us who are uncertain about your plan for life. That's just okay, because it's probably not going to turn out like you plan anyway. My theory in law school was that I was going to be a trial lawyer. That was what I was interested in doing. I wound up taking a position with a defense-oriented but general litigation law firm in Fairmont. And for 20 years or so, I was busy trying cases. And I gave very little thought to being a judge, made no real plans to do so. I did flirt with a couple of district court vacancies. There's some stories there that that might be of some interest, but we won't take our time tonight. But in 1998, there was a vacancy on the Minnesota Court of Appeals that I hadn't really thought too much about. It was created by the retirement of a former Speaker of the House and Court of Appeals judge, Fred Norton. And I got phone calls from a couple of lawyer friends saying, well, you should think about applying. Governor Carlson used a merit selection process. I sort of debated it. The local district court judge called me up and told me I shouldn't do it because all of the real action is in district court, as Judge Lange will be happy to share with you. And as he put it, you know, those appellate judges, they just sit around and think deep thoughts and write papers that nobody reads. Well, I don't know if that's true or not, but Judge Yost, the late Judge Yost now, was a friend of mine and thought maybe I'd be better suited to the district court. But in any event, that's when I started thinking seriously about it. I'd reached a point in life. I was 44 years old. I liked what I was doing. But you had one of those opportunities and you think to yourself, do I want to continue doing this for another 20 years or do I want to try something else? And so for me, it was a real culture shift for me in a whole bunch of ways. That's what prompted it. And just to illustrate the culture shift, and then I'll shut up because there are other people to talk here. I was in a very retail heavy practice, lots of people in and out of the door. This is pre-cell phone. What do you do in that era? You go to a conference. So I went to my very first conference as a judge shortly after my appointment. And I got up in the morning and I called the office, my very new administrative assistant who I'd been introduced to 3 days earlier. And she says, I don't have any messages for you. And I called after the morning break at 10:30. No, I don't have any messages. And then I called her at 1:30 and she said, listen, we have work here to do. If we need you, we'll call you. There's a very real difference between appellate work and the work that the district court judges were doing and the work that I was doing as a trial lawyer. Anyway, long answer, Judge Lange, but there you go.
Thank you so much. We're going to move next to Justice Natalie Hudson to talk about your path to the bench and how you decided to become a judge.
Thank you, Judge Lange. Oh, I'm getting an echo. I don't know if others can hear it, but I'll keep talking. Okay, so maybe it's just me, but thank you. My career has primarily been in the public sector, but in 1994, the job that I think was just transformational for me was I had the opportunity to work at the Attorney General's Office in their Criminal Appellate Division. And it actually came about by accident. I was assigned initially to a different division and had wanted to get into the appellate work, but just hadn't seen an opportunity to do so. And then it just so happened there were some retirements and some maternity leaves in the appellate division. And the manager of the division at the time sent out an email saying, is there anybody, we need help. You know, we need some people to volunteer. Somebody, you know, do help us. And I responded. I said, yeah, I'd love to do that. I'd love to, you know, that's what I wanted to do. And it started with one brief, and then another one came along, and I apparently did well enough with it that they asked me to do another one. But what it turned into is it gave me the opportunity to argue regularly before the Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court. And I loved it. I had done, like I say, I had done a number of different things during my career, but I really knew that I had found my niche doing the appellate work. And then it was after one of my arguments before the Court of Appeals when I walked out and I thought, you know, other than I think it might have been Judge Toussaint at the time, there were no judges of color on the Court of Appeals. And, you know, it just struck me one day. I thought, you know, the law has impacted people of color in just so many ways and largely negative or often negative. But yet we've played a very small role, if any, in the development of the law. And so when this opening came up on the Court of Appeals, several people, kind of like what Justice Anderson was saying, a few people were saying, you ought to think about that. You ought to put your name in. And I, you know, after a while, I thought, yeah, I should. I want to be on the other side of the bench. I think I have something to offer. And so, you know, nothing ventured, nothing gained. So I put my name in, and Jesse Ventura was the governor at the time. The next thing I knew, he appointed me, and that was in 2002. And I spent 13 years on the Court of Appeals. And then Governor Dayton appointed me in 2015 to the Supreme Court. So it came about by just me kind of pushing my way into that appellate division in the Attorney General's office and finding a way to get into the appellate courts, which I've loved.
Did you also find camaraderie with Justice Huspeney and the other judges on the Court of Appeals at the time, the women?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Judge Huspeney, what a jewel. So sorry to see her passing here recently. She was wonderful, as were the other women that were on the court. There was a definite camaraderie there. It was great. I thoroughly enjoyed my 13 years there. Absolutely.
Well, thank you. We're going to move to Justice Janine Kern, who is serving on the Supreme Court in South Dakota, and we'd like you to talk about your journey to the bench, please.
Thank you, Judge Lange. I'd also like to thank you, thank the dean, and thank you all for the opportunity to appear with the distinguished members also of the Minnesota Supreme Court. You know, I graduated in 1985, and I knew I wanted a career in public service, and I had narrowed it down between a position in the Attorney General's office in Pierre, which would be a return home to me to South Dakota, or a position as a public defender in a rural part of Minnesota, because I knew that I desired a career of public service and a more rural lifestyle. And so I took the position in the Attorney General's office and, like Judge Hudson, went into the appellate division there, where I spent 3 years. I also loved my time in the appellate division, and in some ways, my career has come full circle now, serving on an appellate court for the state of South Dakota. I also wanted the opportunity to litigate and to try cases, and so I worked in the drug prosecution unit, and then went on to direct the criminal litigation division. And because we had statewide jurisdiction, I was able to work with law enforcement agencies and to do investigative drug and other criminal grand juries around the state. And that opportunity gave me the chance to start appearing before the judges throughout the state. And I wound up in those years, I was there 11 and a half, 12 years, appearing in front of almost all of the judges in the state. And that inspired me, and it gave me a desire to serve as a judge, as a circuit court judge. My grandfather and father were lawyers. My father had served as a judge, and I admired his service. I admired the process of helping people solve their disputes in a fair and equitable and just forum under the rule of law. There were no women serving on the bench as circuit court judges in South Dakota at all when I started the practice of law. There were one or two magistrate judges, I believe, across the state, but no women on the Supreme Court, no women serving as circuit court judges. And so as I began to practice and appear in front of judges, I thought I eventually developed a confidence to believe that I could serve in that capacity. And I began the process of applying through this merit selection process. And I went on the bench in 96 and served in a busy general jurisdiction court for 18 years. And I must say that through the years now, we have 43 circuit court judges and
Well, I think there's something with the trans
the merit selection that Justice Andrews spoke of. Yes, that that process has changed the composition of the judiciary in South Dakota. And so that's really where my interest began. I was appearing in front of judges across the state and being inspired by the different ways they handled their courtrooms and proceeded.
Well, thank you very much. We're going to have ask Justice Natalie Hudson to answer the next question, which is, knowing that we have alumni and current law students logged on tonight who might be interested in becoming a judge, what experience in your personal background do you think, other than what you've already talked about, prepared you to be a judge?
I think it's really the breadth of practice that I've had. You know, at the Supreme Court, Court of Appeals and Supreme Court, we are very much it's a general jurisdiction court. And so we hear, you know, everything from soup to nuts. And so it can be a civil litigation matter, an employment law matter on the calendar. But right next to that case is a zoning case. And then maybe you've got, you know, a family law matter. And of course, you've got a criminal case as well. And so one of the things that's very helpful, I think, on any of the benches, district court or appellate, but certainly at the appellate level, is to have a breadth of practice. And I developed that over the years. I started my career at Smurls at Legal Aid, and I was a city attorney. So I got into municipal law as a result of that. And I had a short stint in private practice and then at the Attorney General's office. And so I had been exposed to a wide range of practice areas. And I think that's a real benefit on the court because we, as I say, we are very much generalists. And so I would encourage people to think about that. And to the extent, you know, you find something that you love, that's great, but maybe you could branch out in terms of your pro bono work and things like that. So I think it's the breadth of practice. You know, as an appellate judge, we write. You have to have the writing and analytical skills. The bulk of my day is spent either writing opinions or editing opinions. And when I'm not doing that, I'm reading briefs. And but a lot of it is writing. And so you need to be in a position that encourages and forces you to develop those kinds of skills. And so anything that you can do in your practice, if somebody's going to go argue that summary judgment motion, maybe you ought to be the one to write that summary judgment motion as well. And so you really need to develop those strong analytical skills. So I think those are the two chief things that I would mention. And I guess the last thing is, it takes a certain amount of confidence. And I heard Justice Kern mention this. You know, you have to get to the point where, and for some of us, it comes more easily than it does for others. But you have to get to the point where you think, I can do this. And some of that is just learning to deal with the challenges and the setbacks that come in anyone's life. And they come in all of our practices or most of our practices. Things don't always go the way you want. But as you deal with those setbacks and challenges, you begin, I think, over time to develop that sort of grit that you need to say, you know, I can do that. And I think that's separate from ego. Ego, you know, there's some of that too. But it's putting yourself in a position to succeed. And then, you know, on those occasions when it doesn't turn out the way you want, picking yourself back up and moving on from there. So.
Thank you. Justice Kern, could you please talk about the difference of serving as a trial court judge and serving as a Supreme Court justice, the social isolation and the differences in terms of interaction with the lawyers?
Well, it is a great change. I echo what Justice Hudson said about the diversity of practices, a general jurisdiction trial court judge. You are seeing everything, juvenile law, divorce, family law. You know, I'd have 50 hearings during the day. And so I was, you know, actively involved in the community. I knew what all of the resources were that were available to serve the persons that were coming before me. I knew the providers, and so that I could make the appropriate referrals as part of any sentencing decision or order. I knew all of the lawyers. And so I was very engaged in the life of the community and very knowledgeable of the resources that were available. Transitioning to the Supreme Court is a significant difference. You're moving from being a decision maker of one to a form of collective decision making. Our court has five persons. So that's a big transition in and of itself. It involves collegiality, compromise, the ability to articulate your position and to convince others perhaps that you are correct in looking at this approach. You also have to take the long view about the effect of your decisions and how they're going to impact your jurisprudence. You know, a trial court's decision in an individual case doesn't carry that kind of decisional weight. And as you said, Judge, there's also a measure of isolation. Really, it's a complete, in many ways, withdrawal from social networking that may or may not have involved lawyers, at least in community contact. You're not going to have lawyers appearing in front of you at all unless it's in a formally organized and scheduled oral argument. And then you are one of five, one of this collective group of decision makers. It's a significant change. You're also really engaged in many ways in the life of the mind. You are a student of the law. You are writing, researching, studying, editing, doing a deep dive into various areas of jurisprudence. You know, I thought after 18 years on the circuit court bench, I'd pretty much seen every type of law. I found relatively quickly that that's not true. There are many avenues and areas of the law that I've seen now just in my six and a half years serving as an appellate court judge that I had never seen before. Diverse areas of logging, mining, I mean, just a whole host of legal issues involving corporations or entities or legal doctrines that I hadn't encountered before. And that keeps the work fascinating and challenging. But it's a big change.
Thank you. Justice Anderson, can you talk about how the Supreme Court has evolved since you've been on the bench in terms of collegiality and the diversity on the bench? Please turn on your microphone.
There we go. Okay. There we go. I knew this was going to happen. I was going to be reminded to unmute. So it goes with the Zoom, right? So I started on the Supreme Court in 2004. That makes me the senior justice on the court in terms of experience. Mm-hmm. And that and $10 will buy you coffee somewhere. But a couple of observations about that question. Minnesota has been very fortunate during my time on the court and for many of the years that preceded that time in that we've always had a collegial court. Now, there have been, you know, you could find some opinions that suggest otherwise from time to time because, you know, it's we certainly have the ability to point out perhaps fairly sharply about where we think our colleagues have missed the boat, so to speak. But the reality is it is a very collegial court. And I think actually you've got to go back many, many years to find a time period when it wasn't. And I think the way you maintain that is working very hard at putting that foremost. I had an early lesson in this. I had a opinion that I was circulating, and Sam Hansen was the first justice to get it. And this was back in the era when you talk about how things have changed. All of our opinions in that era circulated by paper. Right, my chamber, we had a purple backing for all of our opinions. Other chambers had different colors, and off they would go so that everybody could read them before they got out. I had worked on an opinion that I thought was quite good. I had sent it along to Justice Hansen. He was the next in line to see it. And he sent it back to me with a little parenthetical note on the side saying, perhaps there was a better way to say this. And it was so polite, I almost missed the point. But eventually I figured out what he was talking about. What he was saying was, maybe you don't need to sort of attack the other argument the way in which you had done so. And so I think that that is one of the ways you maintain collegiality. Now, in terms of the diversity piece, I think it's really important. We have a very, very diverse court. I think it's also possible to overemphasize that. I mean, candidly, I'll probably get myself into trouble for saying this, but I don't see a lot of difference. I've got six other colleagues who are, dedicated, involved, working hard. It is true they have different life experiences, and we do hear about that from time to time at conference. And that's useful. But the reality is it would be much different if I was going to report to you that somehow the whole nature of the work of the court has changed. But it hasn't. I think it's important. It's important for external reasons. It's important for the work that the court does in many different communities. But in terms of the work that the court does generally, I'm just thrilled with the colleagues that I have and how hard they work to get to the right answer. So that's how I would answer that question.
Well, that sounds like a well-run ship, and we are proud to hear your assessment.
True. Not always, but most days.
Yes. Our next question is about judicial clerkships, and we'll begin with Justice Kern and ask if a law student is interested in a judicial clerkship, should they begin with a lower court, or do you hire directly from the law school for the Supreme Court in South Dakota?
We do hire directly from the law school, and I have had the pleasure of hiring a U of M graduate who did a wonderful job right out of law school. And so, in thinking about a clerkship, I'd urge any students that are on the call to certainly strongly consider a clerkship. I think the best way to prepare for such a clerkship is to focus on the ability to write, to learn to write well. We look for law review or other journal or writing experience. We need an applicant with excellent familiarity with blue book, red book, citation protocols. We consult and rely on Garner's citation manuals. And look at legal texts that he's really contributed quite a bit to the profession, actually, and some of the work that he's done. Any chance to write either brief writing or motions, to be able to learn how to find the law and then succinctly state it and then analyze the particular scenario presented will really build your skill set. And I encourage students who are thinking about this type of work to read, work on reading retention. There is an enormous amount of reading, more than 5,000 pages a month involved in this kind of work. And the more you can develop your reading and retention skills, your writing skills, the more successful you'll be as a clerk.
Thank you. We'll move next to Justice Anderson. Would you please share with us how many judicial clerks are hired by the Minnesota Supreme Court each year? And are they hired as a group, or do the individual justices hire their own clerks?
So the answer to that question is it could be both in any given year. We hire 11 law clerks. Each member of the court has a law clerk. The six of us, who are not the Chief Justice, share law clerks. Two of us shares a law clerk. So you have basically one and a half law clerks. The chief has two law clerks. We do have a mass application process, and what I'm told by law clerks who've gone through it, a somewhat intimidating interview process with all seven of us asking questions of the applicants. But it is also the case that members of the court may hire outside of that process, but as a tribute to the collegiality, as part of the custom and tradition of collegiality, we generally don't do that until after we've finished with the mass hiring process. For example, my law clerk this preceding year, this is unusual for me, but it just so happened in this particular instance, I hired a law clerk he wasn't selected for the interview process. I went through the interview process and then hired him. That was, members of the court do that from time to time. So that's that is the law clerk hiring process. And I would echo everything that Justice Kern said as well, in terms of, the kinds of qualifications and things we're looking for. And let me just say this to students who might be interested in clerking, but who are looking at sort of, maybe their academic credentials aren't as strong as some students who are applying to be federal district clerks or clerks for the circuit courts. The reality is, particularly if you're open to a clerkship opportunity someplace other than the Twin Cities, there are opportunities for almost any successful student at our three law schools throughout Minnesota. And there are some great career opportunities that come out of that. You have to be willing to assume that there's life outside of the 7-county mosquito control district. And let me tell you, as someone who grew up outside of that, outside of the metropolitan area and practiced law there, there are some great opportunities. And don't close your eyes to them.
Thank you. Justice Hudson, would you have any additional comments in terms of preparing to be a judicial clerk?
I think my colleagues here tonight have largely covered it. I guess the only other thing I would add is don't sell yourself short, because certain justices are looking for one thing, some may be looking for another. If you didn't graduate in the top 5% or 10% of your class, that is not necessarily the death knell. We have, I think, at least one clerk with us now who did not, maybe two, who did not graduate in the top 10% of their class. And so we're looking at all of the things that Justice Kern and Justice Anderson mentioned, but your references are very important. And so if there's a professor that I can talk to that will talk to me and tell me about your classroom performance and your demeanor outside of the classroom, and so maybe you're not in the top 10%, that might get you over the hump. And maybe you weren't on law review. That is generally something we're looking for. But as Justice Kern said, if there are other ways that you can demonstrate that you have the writing ability, maybe you were a journalist before you came to law school, maybe you did other kinds of writing in other settings, those are things that that you could and should highlight. The other reality is Justice Anderson might be looking for one kind of person and I might be looking for someone else. And vice versa. And so you never know what might appeal to the justices. I'm also looking always for someone. I want to know, who are you outside of law school? What else have you done in your community? I want someone that's got some outreach experience and community experience in their lives. And so those are all important factors.
You know, I'm going to jump in. Can I just jump in on this, Judge Lange? And I want to add something that I should have said earlier. And that is, it's certainly, the law review journal experiences are important. And I don't mean to minimize those. But I can also tell you that, at least I personally, have had very good experience hiring students who have been very active in the U of M Law School appellate advocacy programs, the competitive contest kinds of things. The in-depth writing work that you get there and the advocacy work that you do is also really important. So that is not a universally held view. Over the years, I have colleagues who very much value the law school experience, as do I, or the law review experience, as do I. But it is not the only way to demonstrate your abilities to succeed in this environment.
Thank you. I'd like to turn to Justice Kern for the next question, and it's probably our final one. And that is related to the COVID-19 pandemic. Can you tell us what changes the Supreme Court in South Dakota has made in response to the pandemic? And are there any changes that were made that will continue?
You know, like many state courts, we issued an emergency order to keep our courts open and to enact some safety protocols during the pandemic. This order authorized the presiding justice judges in each of the 7 judicial circuits to enact local orders with our Chief Justice's approval and the approval of the court to implement some procedures to try to keep things open. We didn't shut down our courts. We kept them open, but we greatly increased the use of video conferencing, which we call ITV, for both civil and criminal proceedings. And, through that, we gained some remarkable efficiencies and advancements more quickly than we may have liked, and we went further than we may have liked out of necessity. We did suspend jury trials several months in several jurisdictions, but in 2020, South Dakota had 75 cases tried to a jury and more than 2,000 court trials. I was called jury duty yesterday in my local circuit, and was a much different protocol with distancing. I was not selected, by the way. The chairs were spaced 6 feet apart, masks were required. The jurors, I think, felt relatively protected and at ease in light of the protocols that we've developed, consistent with what the CDC has recommended. Our Supreme Court held oral arguments via Zoom for a number of proceedings during the height of the pandemic in the spring of 2020, and then returned to full in-person terms. Appearing orally for argument before the Supreme Court was certainly a different experience for the lawyers. I felt badly in many respects for those who were making their first appearance before the court in that way. I think that you lose something. We're still doing many civil hearings and motions by ITV as the pandemic resolves, whether it'll be in 1 or 2 or 3 years, we'll need to do some balancing so that we can gain efficiencies but not lose the value of in-person proceedings. Certainly in my years as a trial court judge, it was important to me to be able to have that in-person contact, certainly with the entry of pleas and sentencing and family law proceedings. We have done some live streaming for certain proceedings, voluntarians, initial appearances, arraignments in Minnehaha County. For members of the public, we're also providing a public viewing area, and that's greatly increased access. That pilot project's been very successful. We've gained some efficiencies, but there will need to be a balance achieved as we move forward and feel our way forward.
Well, thank you very much. We'll turn to Justice Barry Anderson. And could you talk about the Supreme Court's procedures during COVID and also whether or not more online technology is being considered to give citizens greater access to the courts?
So we have historically been very tech friendly in terms of access to our courts. In other words, for at least 15 years, we've had available on a delayed basis video of our oral arguments. And then a few years ago, we moved to live streaming of our arguments on the day of the argument itself. In other words, anybody's been able to see those arguments. When the pandemic hit a year ago, we canceled some oral arguments and then moved almost immediately to a virtual oral argument setting. And we have continued in that setting to this day. I think that we'll finish out this term, May and June, and then we'll see what September brings. I haven't discussed it with my colleagues. No votes have been taken. What follows is my opinion, but I think it's very probable that there'll be some form of return to live oral argument in September. Candidly, I think it's worked pretty well, and we've had pretty good feedback from the lawyers who have participated. One of the things that we've done, incidentally, is we instituted a practice which I think is going to survive the Zoom experience, which is giving the advocates 3 minutes at the start of their presentation to give some uninterrupted time to tell the court why their side should prevail. We have a very active bench, and in the prior universe in which we operated, you didn't get 3 minutes. You might get a half a minute, mm-hmm. or maybe a minute if you're lucky. So you know, there are going to be things that we're going to continue to do via Zoom. You know, there may be some rule committee meetings. It certainly has allowed participation from people in all parts of Minnesota in a way in which, you know, a full day travel might have made that less practical. But I think in general, the thing that you lose is body language and the gestalt, so to speak, of the conversation that helps you decide what you're going to do with a case. And I always illustrate this by talking about my former colleague, David Lillehog. I could look down the bench and I could see him getting all wound up to ask somebody a question, and you could see that finger beginning to rotate as he's aiming for the microphone button. Well, you lose all of that in the electronic environment. I will say, at the district court level, we were talking about this before we came on air, so to speak. Judge Lange and I were visiting a little bit about this. I think that it doesn't work as well for contested proceedings, evidentiary kinds of proceedings, but certainly for preliminary hearings and other. Other similar kinds of proceedings, I wouldn't be at all surprised to see us maintain something like this in the post-pandemic environment, simply because it's more convenient for the lawyers, it's more convenient for the parties as well. I don't think sentencing works as well for obvious reasons. It's hard to commit the defendant to the Commissioner of Corrections virtually. That doesn't work very well. But in other respects, I think we're going to see some more use of Zoom and equivalent technologies.
Thank you,
Judge Lange. May I add a few things?
Yes, you're next.
Okay, you were coming to me anyway. Okay, sorry. Thank you. I would echo everything that Justice Anderson said, but I just want to add a couple other things to it. As he mentioned, we started giving attorneys 3 minutes at the beginning to state their position. And what's been interesting is to watch how attorneys use that time. The really good appellate attorneys use it effectively. They have They frame their argument. They, in those 3 minutes, they take you from beginning to end. They highlight the law that's relevant, why, you know, that's in their favor. And they come out with a concise statement about what they want the court to do. The less experienced or not, you know, not as talented, if you will, appellate attorneys end up kind of wandering here and there, here and there. And they don't take a good, they don't make good use of that time. But the attorneys love it so much. I mean, we've heard a lot of feedback. So Justice Anderson's absolutely right about that. So that's something we may continue with. I don't know what we'll do. And correct me if I'm wrong, Justice Anderson, I don't think we voted on this, you know, right now, so that you don't have this sort of hodgepodge that you have when you're in person. We ask questions in order of seniority. And so I think the lawyers like that as well, because it's predictable. And so the chief, on some cases, will start with Justice Anderson if she herself doesn't have something to ask. And so she'll start with Justice Anderson as the senior judge, then me, and then down the line. And then other days she'll start at the other end with Justice Moore, and we go back up the ladder. But you know, as an attorney, who the next question's coming from. And I think they like that, as opposed to the sort of, you know, firing squad kind of thing that's going on. The one thing, though, that I have missed doing in person, and this is to pick up on something Justice Anderson said, I think it is harder, though, for the attorneys. Not only is it harder for us to read each other, as Justice Anderson was talking about, and that's important, but I think it's harder for the attorneys to read us as well. It's very difficult to pick up cues about, you know, and to take the temperature of the full court on Zoom. And you just don't have that same eye contact, body language. And I think that can make a significant difference in your argument, because you should be picking up on what's going on that bench. And then the other way that I think it has been a detriment is we stopped conferencing after oral arguments in person. And so we do our conferencing by Zoom as well. And that, I think, has been a negative in a sense, because when you work, and it goes back to something Justice Kern said, when you work with, for us, seven people, we're a small group, we're a tight-knit group, we spend a lot of time with each other. It is important, as you're discussing these, you know, difficult legal issues, that you be able to see one another and talk to one another and really communicate with each other. And particularly when we don't agree with each other, when there's a strong dissent possibly in the group, it's important that we see that and be able to engage with each other in that way. And so in that sense, I feel badly for Justice Moore, our newest justice, because he only had a couple of, if maybe one or two, if that, where we met in person so that he could get a sense of how we do what we do. But for all of us, I think the sooner we're able to get back to that, the better we'll be. So there are pros and cons to it. There have been pros and cons, no question. So thank you.
Well, that is a very, very teachable moment for all the lawyers that are listening, in terms of how to prepare themselves to come before the Supreme Court in South Dakota or Minnesota. And I hope the law students have been able to hear about a pathway to clerkships. And if there are any questions, I know we have a staff that is prepared to Elisa to give those out.
Yes, I'll encourage everyone to use the Q&A function at the bottom and to put your questions in there. And it looks like Dean Jenkins actually has a question. So we'll start there.
Okay.
Great. Thank you. So my question is about a phenomenon we're seeing at the U.S. Supreme Court level, which is the growth of the specialized bar, right? There was always a specialized Supreme Court bar, but from what I'm understanding, it's growing in the sense that they're taking a larger and larger percentage of the cases are handled by the same kind of set of attorneys at the U.S. Supreme Court level. Is that a phenomenon that you're seeing at the state level? And if so, is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? Would it be a good thing to have more concentration of cases with a specialized Supreme Court bar at the state level?
So let me take a run at that. I do think we are seeing some of that in terms of, we see many more of the same advocates. On the other hand, we still see quite a few cases represented by attorneys who we'll see one or two times and never see them again. And I don't really want to see the day where it's a specialized bar. I mean, there's going to be some specialization just by virtue of the types of cases that come before us. If you've got a complex hospital administration legal issue, you're probably going to get a big downtown law firm that specializes in that. That's kind of the way it goes. But the only comment I would make is, if you don't have an opportunity to regularly appear in an appellate court, either at the Court of Appeals or the Supreme Court, you really do need to prepare for that. And you need to think about the fact that this is not a trial, a court appearance. And you need to think about how you're persuading appellate lawyers or appellate judges to see the wisdom of your argument as an appellate lawyer. And there will continue to be some specialization, but I don't want to see us go the route where you just very infrequently see somebody new.
Okay, any other comments?
I would just add that we see obviously the lawyers from the Attorney General's office who are appearing on behalf of the state frequently. But we have quite a diverse bar as far as those who are appearing for appellate advocacy. And, you know, I would echo what Justice Anderson said, that you do need to prepare if it's your first or second argument before an appellate court. And I really think that that moot court process where you present your argument to three or four or five or more persons prior to giving it live is really a helpful process. I also agree that I wouldn't want to see just a specialized core of appellate lawyers who appeared. I like to see a broad variety of attorneys appearing before the court and arguing their positions.
Thank you. Justice Hudson, any comment?
No, I completely agree with my colleagues.
Okay. Well, we are at 8:00. I'm going to turn it over to Dean Jenkins.
Great. Well, unless there are any additional questions that have come in on the Q&A, Alyssa, are we...
Sure. Actually, I was just going to say, so one that came in, licensing reforms is something that's been talked about, especially with some of the challenges around holding bar exams during the pandemic. What are your thoughts on diploma privilege, and should it be considered more widely?
So I'm going to take a run at that as the justice assigned in our court to the Board of Law Examiners. And I know this is a sensitive topic and it's a really complicated issue. So we're probably not going to get to the bottom of it tonight. But a couple of observations here. There have been some states in the coronavirus era who have experimented with a diploma privilege. Minnesota had the opportunity to do that and declined. We have administered our bar exams as scheduled and successfully without incident. And we're going to be probably continuing to do that. Now, the question is, going forward, what about diploma privileges and the like? That is a question that the court has never, or court in my time, has not directly addressed. We've had a bar exam since the early 1920s. We used to have the diploma privilege, moved away from it in that era because of unsatisfactory experiences. And the problem that the bar exam presents in this sense is the law schools are in a different place than the Supreme Court. Supreme Court's in a position where it needs to be concerned with lawyer competence and protecting the public. I'm not suggesting law schools aren't concerned about that. Of course they are. But they're in a different place on this question than the Supreme Court. I mean, they're interested in students coming in, students being successful, students graduating. That's all great. We have great relationships with all three of our law schools. We value those relationships. We're hoping to see them continue. But if we're going to protect the public, how do we go about doing that? And candidly, for almost all of the professions that I can think of, architecture, professional engineering, medical, medicine, certified public accountants, and the legal business, we still have a bar exam. So I think my own personal view is I'm not an advocate at this point for moving to a diploma privilege, but I am. It's interesting to watch the innovation that's going on in that space about improving the bar exam, focusing more on some skill-based kinds of issues. The advent of the uniform bar exam has really helped in this regard because it's given students in Minnesota much broader opportunities. And we're now approaching almost 40 jurisdictions that take the UBE. So I understand the question. It's a great question. There are arguments for the diploma privilege. I would not suggest that there aren't, but I don't see any immediate change in our practice. Now, keep in mind, the full court gets to vote on that, and six of them could tell me I'm completely wrong. It happens periodically anyway. So, you know, we'll see what happens, but that's my.
The only thing I guess I would add to that, Judge Lange, is, there's a lot of research out there now about, the efficacy of the bar and what does it really tell you? And is it the best measure of competency? And I think, there's strong arguments that can be made that it is not. But again, there's a lot of research ongoing, as Justice Anderson indicated. So we'll just have to see where that goes. But as Justice Anderson said, we've had the bar here in Minnesota since 1921. And when you look around the nation, very few states, I want to say it's maybe two or three, actually utilize the diploma privilege. And so that in and of itself says something. And my concern with it is twofold. One, if a student, say, from the U has a job elsewhere and that employer is requiring that they've passed the bar, that's what they need to do, is they need to pass a bar. And having the diploma privilege is not going to be sufficient in those instances. When it came to us this past summer, as Justice Anderson said, we decided against it. But part of that was because of the extraordinary measures that our Board of Law Examiners went to, and Justice Anderson alluded to this, to make sure that the bar examination was as safe as possible. We split it in multiple sites so that people weren't all together. There were staggered entrance times. There were limited, we limited the number of people in a particular room. St. Thomas Law School gave us the opportunity to hold, to put some folks there. And a number of other things. And so, and fortunately, all went well. And to our knowledge, there were no COVID-19 infections. It is a difficult puzzle and a difficult conversation. And we also amended our student practice rules to allow students to be able to practice if they were not able to sit for the bar immediately. So we had a very long discussion, and as Justice Anderson said, we're probably not completely done with it, but we felt comfortable where we came out in July, and I think we came to the right decision.
Thank you. Justice Kern, we want to talk about what has happened in South Dakota at the Supreme Court level to improve equity and diversity within the legal system. Do you see any initiatives, or have there been any initiatives or measurements to look at the impact of the court on diversity and justice in terms of the people who come before the court?
Well, we have been fortunate in that the Supreme Court, through the leadership of our former Chief Justice, David Gilbertson, who served for over 20 years, really formed some remarkable partnerships with our executive and legislative branches. to bring about some pretty significant system reforms that I think have impacted the system across the board. We went through some revisions to both the adult and the juvenile justice systems, looking for alternatives to certainly out-of-home placements for juveniles only in the most serious circumstances, and worked really to build much stronger community resources to serve children at home. The modifications in the adult system were quite far-reaching, including modification of some criminal penalties, as well as a requirement for presumptive probation. You know, 15 years ago, South Dakota didn't have any problem-solving courts. We now have 19 specialty courts focusing on treatment, rehabilitation, outcomes other than incarceration. They've served about 2,500 people. We've had some remarkable success in our DUI drug veteran and now two mental health courts, which will graduate their first successful participants this summer. Further, we've developed in a pilot project through the Hensley Foundation, a way to provide virtual crisis care for those coming into the systems with access to mental health providers for persons who need that initially upon arrest and other points in the system. And we have 8 counties that are in the implementation phase. You know, we're also a very rural state. And so we had the problem where in many circumstances, folks had to drive more than 100 miles perhaps to consult with a lawyer. You know, now we're seeing some real improvements having been through the pandemic with the opportunities it created for ITV and remote access to counsel. But we developed a rural attorney program that provides some funding for young attorneys if they will move to a qualifying rural county with a population of less than 10,000 persons. And that's now been, this pilot was extended by the legislature and to fund 32 spots for 32 young lawyers who would go into these very rural counties and commit to stay for 5 years in exchange for this very modest 5-year stipend. And we currently have 27 counties that have lawyers participating. This program is so unique that it's been recognized by the ABA, and we've received interest from other states around the country. So there are many positive things underway to try to better serve the persons appearing.
Thank you very much. We're going to turn to Justice Hudson and ask about the Minnesota Supreme Court in terms of its leadership and initiatives to increase equity and diversity. We know that 25 years ago, there was the Minnesota Supreme Court Commission on Racial Bias in the Courts, and also prior to that, a Minnesota Supreme Court Commission on Gender Fairness in the Courts. But could you talk about the ongoing activities of the Minnesota Supreme Court?
Yes, we right now have a committee that is a part of our judicial council, which of course is the guiding body of the court, the Committee on Equality and Inclusion, I believe is the formal name, and that's the liaison to that committee is Justice Chudich. And they have been engaged in a wide range of activities and continue to be so. One of the things that has come out of that committee, just as an example, is a implicit bias bench card that the district court judges have been using now for several years, which encourages the judges themselves to look at their decision making and, you know, would they, for instance, make the same decision if the person before them were of a different race or a different gender or a different background. And so it helps district court judges, you know, get at the implicit biases that we all carry, just because of our background. And I know one of the things that recently came out of that committee, and I believe was approved by the Judicial Council, and Justice Anderson, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it was recently approved and is in use, is an implicit bias jury instruction that is given now. Thank you. I got the thumbs up. That is given to jurors now to make jurors aware of potential biases that they may have and how to address those. And so I think those kinds of initiatives are so important. The committee has also been involved in the speaking sessions, and I may have the wrong terminology for it, but where we've set up conversations in communities of color and other communities periodically to get input from the community about how they're feeling about, you know, and what is going on, and to explain judicial processes so that people have a better understanding of how the court system works and what they can expect and why certain things happen. So those are just some of the initiatives. Obviously, there's been some work on bail reform as well. And it's an ongoing process. It is certainly an ongoing process. I do think, however, though, you know, that as a community and as a society, when we think about criminal justice reform, we need to also keep our eye not only on the consequences, because by the time you get to the court system, that's a consequence. We need to be looking at what causes people to come into the system, and in particular, what causes people of color to come into the system. And so then I think if we can get our heads around, okay, we need to be looking at educational disparities. Yes. We need to be looking at housing disparities and health disparities, because if we can get a handle on that, because as we all know, you know, education is the great equalizer. And so if people are able to afford to feed their children and to get good jobs and to have living wages, some of the criminal activity we see will be lessened. And so it's not a binary kind of choice. I think we have to engage in, it's about, you know, what do we do in the criminal justice system, but how do we, what do we do on the other end on the cause factor? And then the last thing I would say is, you know, we just need to keep, and the court has worked on this as well, encouraging and making sure that we're getting people of diverse backgrounds into every aspect of the judicial system, so that there are as many women and people of color who are prosecutors. And so it's not just the judges, because we all know the tremendous discretion that prosecutors have in the judicial system. And so whether to, you know, who to charge, whether to charge, what to charge, and the most important power they have, which is the power to plea bargain, and whether to offer those plea bargains. So it's a holistic, you know, picture that we have to get our heads around and be committed to. And I think, you know, the Supreme Court is helping to lead the way in those efforts. So those are my thoughts.
Well, thank you. And Justice Anderson, the final question that's been provided to me is, do judges have a role in bringing important legal or judicial issues to the attention of the legislature or to the public?
So my answer to that is, we have a role, but it's limited. It's limited in the context of the case that is before us. We may have lots of opinions about what sentencing should look like or what particular sentences the legislature should use to attempt to punish people engaged in certain kinds of behavior. But it comes up only in the context of a specific case. And candidly, members of the court have differing levels of comfort. In the course of my 20 years, I'm thinking of some of my colleagues who have served and have since retired. Some were very willing to, you know, offer advice in the context of a concurring opinion or a footnote in a majority opinion if nobody squawked too loudly in the rest of the majority. And there are others who felt very strongly that really should be left to the legislature. It's a separation of powers problem, and we do have to be conscious of that we have certain limited areas where we have authority, and the legislature has other areas of authority. I just would say, just observe on the whole sentencing issue. I've been at this long enough now. I started practicing in 1979, and this was pre-sentencing guidelines, before the sentencing guidelines came in. They came in part, and I'm engaging in gross oversimplification here, but sentencing guidelines came in part because of some perceived unfairness in terms of disparity, in terms of sentences that judges were offering. I now read in the newspaper that there are concerns that maybe there should be some changes made to sentencing, that perhaps some offenses, there should be more flexibility in terms of how prisoners behave in prison and thus eligible for release on an earlier basis. Well, that's a model that we had, and then we kind of moved away, and now we're talking about, these are all policy decisions that the legislature gets to make. We may have opinions about them. We may comment about them from time to time. But for the most part, we need to respect the legislative role here and administer the law as it's been given to us, and subject to, the inherent authority that the judiciary has.
Thank you. Is there, Justice Kern, is there an onboarding process for a Supreme Court Justice in South Dakota? Do you have a manual or procedural orientation?
We do have internal court rules, but we have a very collegial court that has been very engaging with our new members. I've served on the court now for 6.5 years, and I am our senior justice. Our court has undergone, as has our trial court bench, what I would call a silver tsunami of retirements, where many persons have retired from our circuit court bench, probably 20, more than 20, probably pushing half of our judiciary, and our entire Supreme Court has retired in the last 6.5 years. And so, we have internal court rules that are written, and then our institutional memory and heritage about the case processing and so on, and a very collegial court and a very strong group of now retired justices. Our court was also committed in staggering also the retirements so that people could be appointed in a gradual fashion, and that's been profoundly helpful.
Okay, thank you. Justice Hudson, is there a formal onboarding process or manuals to help a justice get started on the Minnesota Supreme Court?
Well, I think yes and no, and I may need your help on this, Justice Anderson, but when I came on board 5 years ago, there was nothing formal. I mean, we too obviously have internal operating procedures and all of that. But because, as Justice Kern was talking about, it is a collegial court, folks reached out to me, first and foremost, actually was Justice Anderson, and said, this is how I do what I do, and this is how it works, and this is what I do, and this is what you can expect, and here's some samples of things, and this is how I take my conference notes, and it was just tremendously helpful to me. We're fortunate in that, although we've had that same tsunami, here in Minnesota, particularly at the district court level, not quite as much at the appellate level, but we're getting close there as well. We're fortunate that, as Justice Anderson,
okay,
did I turn my mic on?
Yes.
Hi. Justice Anderson's been with the court, 16, 17 years, something like that. The chief has been with us 15 years. So we have that institutional memory. But kind of like Justice Kern was talking about, once you get past Justice Anderson, it drops to me. And I've been on the court 5 years. And so I'm now the, you know, second in seniority after Barry. But I do think, and I'll let Justice Anderson speak to this, when Justice Moore came on last year replacing Justice Lilhog, I do believe the chief kind of assigned you, Justice Anderson, we decided we should do something a little more formal. And I do, and the chief assigned Justice Anderson to kind of work with Justice Moore. And I think that's been a good thing. But again, people from the court reached out to me. And like I say, Justice Anderson being the first one, I think, actually to do that. And that was tremendously helpful. So I'll add.
Yeah, no, in fact, we don't have a formal process, but it was apparent in this pandemic era that we needed to do something that was more than the ad hoc version of things that we've been doing previously. And so I set up weekly conference calls with Justice Moore, and we went through the process and procedures. A lot of this is set out in rule, but candidly, one of the problems with trying to put together a manual or a formal onboarding process is it's all custom and tradition. And much of it is. And, you know, you convey that by experience. And of course, in the middle of a pandemic, it's a little hard to do that. So I think that we are. In fact, it's the question that you raise, Judge Lange, is very much on the minds of the Chief Justice, because she's identified that as a long range planning point that we need to have a conversation about. So come back to us in a year or two, and we may actually have a fancy little book and a brochure and a video and maybe a TikTok or an Instagram, whatever those things are, to kind of help people get grounded.
Well, thank you very much. I'm going to ask Alyssa if there are any other questions from the audience.
Yeah, we have one. I think we've got time for one more. So this one came in. It said, the panel talked about the benefit of general practice, yet it seems that law firms seem to be focused more on creating and hiring specialists in the legal field. How would you advise a student who's more interested in that general practice to advocate for themselves and to be able to do that with their career?
I'm going to take a run at this. It's something I have a real interest in. And the questioner is absolutely correct, particularly larger law firms. They do make an effort to rotate people around, but the reality is that there is a specialization component. And you certainly can't find... I mean, they're paying you, right? So you can't fight against that. But you can look for other opportunities, volunteer opportunities. I was surprised when I joined the Supreme Court. And one of the things we do as an outreach is we go out and talk to various groups. And I was surprised at the number of pro bono opportunity kinds of things that are out there. And you obviously have to check with your employer and see that it doesn't create any issues. But you have to kind of work at it a little bit. And I would offer one other little piece of advice, sort of more generally on that topic, and that would be this. Look for opportunities to get outside of your comfort zone. If you see the world in a particular way and your friends are all kind of in that same camp, look for an opportunity to be with people who have differing views on questions. One of the great advantages I had as a practicing lawyer is, the lawyer that you're opposing today, you might be representing dad and he might be representing mom in a family law matter. Next week, it might be the reverse. You might be on the plaintiff's side. That same lawyer might be on the defense side. It might be the reverse the next week. You have to look for opportunities more generally, I think, in this era of, siloing. People, siloing their lives, look for opportunities to get outside of that silo. And I have to say candidly, if you want to be a judge someday, it is helpful to be able to point to a broad spectrum of people who are willing to say, I worked with him or her on this matter. And although we didn't agree, it was a very professional kind of relationship. We've stayed in professional contact in the years that followed. That's a very powerful testimony to somebody who's going to be deciding issues and maybe deciding issues in a way she or he doesn't like to decide them simply because the law requires it. So that would be just some general advice that I would offer on that whole specialization thing. Look for ways to get out of your comfort zone, whatever that might mean to you.
Well, I think we are so close We would turn it over to Dean Jenkins to be able to sign us out. Thank you very, very much, every one of you, for your candor, your wisdom, and for the time that you spent this evening with our audience.
Indeed. Thank you so much. And let me add, Justice Anderson, Justice Hudson, Justice Kern, Judge Lange, we so appreciate you and your insights. This was really terrific. And we are so proud of you. I always say a Minnesota law degree can take you anywhere, and you are great examples of that and your inspirations, all four of you. So this has been a terrific discussion. For those of you celebrating Spring Alumni Weekend, we have more events. We look forward to seeing you there. Congratulations. Thank you all. Good night.